Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you all for finding your seats and coming to the final session. So we welcome you to Vanderbilt's 5th annual 3-minute thesis competition, a research communication competition developed by the University of Queensland, which challenges students to present a compelling oration on their thesis and its significance in just 3 minutes and in a language appropriate to a non-specialist audience. I would like to invite now GSC President Lucy to say a few words before we start.
Thank you, Candace. Thank you all for coming to the final round. This is one of GSC's most exciting events. We're really proud of it. We're really excited to have you all here. We're really thrilled to have this excellent panel of judges, and we're excited the Chancellor's here to make some final remarks after you all do your final presentations. Erin and Jacqueline, our two VPs of Academic Affairs, have really put in countless hours into making this run smoothly, along with a big group of volunteers, and so I'd like to just real quick give them a round of applause, because I think they've done a really good job. And on that same note, if you've enjoyed today and you're interested in getting more involved, we are right now holding nominations for Graduate Student Council Exec Board, and we have a whole lot of spots open. And so I really would encourage you to consider running, or if you know someone who you think would be really good in that leadership capacity, consider nominating them. We're all run by volunteers and by students, and I think it's a really excellent opportunity to get involved. And it really helps build leadership skills, but also build kind of relationship skills along with a lot of graduate students across disciplines, which I've found really valuable. So I would encourage you to do that if you're interested. We sent out a form last week, but if you have lost it in your email, please come talk to either me or everyone on our exec board has, I'm not wearing my name bagged, but everyone else has one that says GSC exec board on it. And so find someone with that and just ask them for the form, and we'd be so excited to get you on our team. So with that, I would like to introduce Dean Wallace. He's gonna say a couple words on behalf of the grad school.
Thank you, Lucy. Thanks, everyone, for coming. It's really a delight to be at this event today. One of my favorite British words is the word gobsmacked. The first time I came to this event a couple years ago, I was absolutely gobsmacked. It was really just so much fun to listen to both the quality and the diversity of the work that's being done here on campus in the graduate arena. I also do want to acknowledge that this is really a totally student-directed endeavor. So the GSC, the folks that Lucy mentioned, have been really instrumental in putting this together, and I really, kudos go out to them. This is always such a well-organized, well-run event. The final thing is I just want to tell a little bit of a story, just real quick. The Chancellor knows this, so last month we gave a presentation to the Board of Trust that was focused on graduate education. And I got up and I did my, 10 or 15 minute dog and pony show. But at the end of that, I asked several of the past winners of the 3-minute thesis to come up and just to do a reprise of their award-winning presentations. And they were spectacular, so much so that afterwards a few of the board members came up to me and they said, your stuff was okay, but man, those students were fabulous. So with that, please enjoy the event. It's really one of my favorite academic events of the entire year. Thank you.
Hi again, everybody. Congratulations to all the participants who've qualified for this round. By the end of this session, the judges will have determined the winner of the first prize, who receives $1,000, and the runner-up, who receives $500. We are now passing around voting ballots for the People's Choice. You should have gotten those already. And they will be awarded $350, and that's whoever receives the most votes from the audience. All other finalists who have qualified for this round will receive a $100 prize. To ensure fairness, you can only submit a ballot if you have been in the room to see every presentation. We will collect the ballots immediately after the last presentation. Participants are eligible for only one prize. If the first and second place tie, we will split the total prize between them. After the presentation, we will hold registration raffle for all the contestants involved. Finally, we will hold the award ceremony. To collect your prize, make sure that you give your contact information to one of the organizers so that we can share this with you. So I will now introduce our judges for the final session, followed by a brief review of the competition rules. After, I will call up our first participant to give their presentation, followed by a 1-minute pause for applause and for the next participant to take the stage, and that will continue through. Please make sure your phones are on silent to support our participants. Our judges for this session are Dr. Cliff Anderson, Associate University Librarian for Research and Learning, Dr. Susan Barone, Executive Director of Global Learning and Education, Michael Cass, Mayor's Office, Speechwriter and Communications Advisor, Claudia Dean, Vice President for Research, Pew Research Center, Morgan Massengill, The Bobby Bones Show, Producer at iHeartMedia, Trisha Rose Burt, Professional Storyteller, Memoir Writer, Solo Performer, and Visual Artist, and finally, Dr. Mark Wallace, Dean of the Graduate School. So, I know that you have heard these in previous sessions, but just to reiterate a little bit, the official rules for the competition are: presentations are limited to 3 minutes maximum, and competitors exceeding 3 minutes are disqualified. Presentations are considered to have commenced when a presenter starts their presentation through speech. A single static PowerPoint slide is permitted. No slide transitions, animations, or movement of any description are allowed. The slide is to be presented from the beginning of the oration. Memory aids of any kind are not allowed, and work must be presented from a planned or in-process dissertation or thesis, and it must be original work. And then the decision of the panel is also final. So I'm not sure what room you were in before, and I know there are different timekeepers, so I just, for everybody to have the same timekeeping, Claudia will explain how her system works.
Hey guys, so I'm the other Claudia. I'm having time on my phone. So when the time starts, I'm going to hold up the green piece of paper. I'll hold it up for 2 minutes and 30 seconds. So when I put it down, it means you have 30 seconds left. Then when you have 15 seconds left, I'm going to hold up the orange piece of paper. And then when you have to stop, I'm going to hold up the red piece of paper. Yeah. So
great. We will now begin. Please remember, for the sake of fairness, clapping is allowed only after the participant's presentation. So, first up, we have Elizabeth Lanphier with A House is Not a Home, But Why You Ought to Offer Hospitality in Each.
So try to imagine with me, it's 5 to 10 years from now. You live in a coastal city where you have a job you love, you've earned tenure, and you own your own house. However, sea levels are rising, and in the foreseeable future, your life might be literally underwater. Your job that was supposedly forever is gone, your property is worthless, and you and your community are forced into displacement. What rights do you think you have in this situation? And what do you think others would owe you? So this might seem like a hard-to-imagine scenario, but this is, due to climate change, a very real possibility for many communities and individuals who are being forced into displacement. One example is the people of the Kiribati Republic, a constellation of islands in the South Pacific that are no more than 6 feet above sea level. Sea levels are predicted to rise 5 to 6 feet within the next century. So do the Kiribati people have the right to become citizens of another country? Are we obligated to welcome them, for example, here in the United States? And if so, does this infringe on our own rights to our sovereign territory and nation state? So you can see there's a tension between our individual and community-held rights, such as to land, houses, territory, and citizenship, and our responsibilities toward others, particularly the duty to offer hospitality and to relieve suffering. In my dissertation, I am going to suggest that rights are not things we should own, even though there's a long history in the tradition of philosophy of understanding rights as possessions. I'm calling this the house model of rights. However, the reason we can own houses is that there's an institution we form, such as the institution of private property. And often, these institutions are grounded in and reproduce systems of inequality and injustice. So instead, I want to offer what I'm calling a home model of rights. And I understand homes to be both literal and figurative spaces that we form together, share in, and belong to, rather than things that belong to us. So how does this home model address the tension between rights and responsibilities? According to it, justice would demand that we share with others even that which we own, and that rights are part of, rather than counter to, the sets of obligations we have toward others. Look, we can still own things. However, ownership is not our ethics. Instead, we should understand that justice is participating in and belonging among others. So where does this leave us with the climate refugee, whether it's the Kiribati people or our imagined or future potential selves? What I'm going to suggest is that the planet and its territories are not houses that those who have the status, power, or mere luck to possess can have exclusive ownership and control over. Instead, the planet and its territories should be a home where we are all welcomed and belong. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Next up, we have Allison Gilmour, and can Sichang Lu come up to the front to get her mic on? So next, we have Allison Gilmour with Teaching Students with Disabilities is Associated with Teacher Turnover.
What does a bad special education teacher look like? Me, because I'm not teaching anymore. Special education teachers have a really hard job. They not only work with students with the most significant learning and behavior needs, but they also act as consultants to other teachers, as case managers for families, and even lawyers as they fill out paperwork. This is likely why principals throughout the country report high levels of special education teacher turnover and problems filling special education positions. This leaves the most vulnerable students, students with disabilities, without the teachers that are specially trained in the skills they need to succeed in school. Ironically, I became a researcher focused on why teachers leave teaching. Because teacher turnover is considered a national crisis with negative effects on student achievement, many researchers have looked at reasons teachers leave teaching. But no one has quantitatively looked at if teaching students with disabilities is directly associated with turnover. Using a state data set with millions of students and hundreds of thousands of teachers, I set out to estimate, does teaching students with disabilities lead to teacher turnover? And what I found was that teaching students with intellectual disabilities and behavior disorders significantly increased the odds of teacher turnover. A teacher that worked with students with behavior disorders had about 7 times the odds of leaving teaching than a teacher that wasn't teaching students with disabilities. So this suggested that teaching the most challenging groups of students within the disability categories was associated with turnover. But there's hope. This association did not hold in every school. So this suggests that it isn't the students that are causing the teachers to leave, but rather the supports that different schools offer teachers who are working with these really challenging students. So my research going forward can look at what these schools are doing to support teachers. And I can use that information to design programs and interventions that will keep special education teachers in the classroom and in turn improve outcomes for students with disabilities. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Can Edward Van Opstal come up to be mic'd for next? Okay, next we have Sichang Lu with resorbable nanocomposites with bone-like strength and enhanced cellular activity.
Last night I was very hungry, so I decided to cook lobster spaghetti for dinner. On the left is a dream dish in my mind, a creamy, perfect blend of lobster and spaghetti. Delicious. However, I ended up with the thing on the right. As a PhD student, I'm always eager to find out why. I tried several times, and only after I added a secret ingredient did I finally succeed. The problem I faced in my PhD project is somehow similar to this spaghetti problem. In my PhD project, we develop bone grafts, which are used for filling the gap where the injured bone can't heal by itself. There are two kinds of bone grafts currently on the market. One of them is a polymer with long molecule chains, just like spaghetti strips. They're strong, which is good because bone grafts need to bear weight. However, they are biologically inert, meaning that it doesn't interact with patient's host bone, which can cause serious problems in the long term. On the other hand, we have ceramics. They are like lobsters. Bone cells love them, but they are too weak to bear weight. People have been trying to combine these two materials together, but they always end up with things like that. The addition of ceramic always makes the graft too weak to bear weight due to poor dispersion. Now it's time to solve the mysteries. For the spaghetti problem, I added cheese to help the lobster pieces stick to the spaghetti strips when I blend them. And in this way, I get perfect blend of spaghetti and lobster. And for the bone grafts, similarly, I graft the polymer chain onto the surface of ceramic particles. And in this way, I can disperse the ceramic particles really well in the polymer phase. And I found that the addition of grafted ceramics make the graft stronger and sufficient to bear weight. This is due to the extra bonding between the ceramic particles and the polymer, and the even dispersion of the particles. And I also found that the cells loved my graft as much as they love ceramics. They make dense sheet of bone mineral on my graft, just as they make on their ceramics. So the outcome of my PhD project is a bone graft that is both strong and biologically active. I hope my work can help patients reduce their pain and heal faster and fully recover from their injuries. Thank you.
Thank you. Can Archana come up to be mic next? Okay. Now, presenting, we have Edward Van Opstal with Making a Microbiome, Nature versus Nurture.
When you looked at yourself in the mirror this morning, did you realize that a unique set of microbes called your microbiome was staring back at you? Our microbiome consists of trillions of bacterial cells that comprise roughly 50% of the cells in or on our body at all times. Added together, our microbiome weighs roughly 3 pounds. That's the weight of your brain. These microbes reside on your skin, in your mouth, and as the focus of my talk, in your gut. The gut microbiome plays a critical role as a digester, making vitamins and carbohydrates accessible to your nutrition, as well as a protector, defending your body against the countless pathogens around you. Now, recent studies from the Human Microbiome Project, which is a $100 million NIH initiative with 300 human subjects, showed no two people share the same microbiome. So where do our unique microbiomes come from? Our current understanding is that microbiomes are formed by genetic factors, or by environmental factors, such as where we live and what we eat. My lab focuses on the genetic impacts on the microbiome. My project asks the question, does an individual's genome require a particular microbiome for peak health and development? And so I'm working to answer this question by performing microbiome transplants, also known as fecal or poop transplants, between hosts with different genetic backgrounds. And so ideally, I would really want to perform these on humans, but I found no healthy person really wants a transplant of foreign poop. I mean, seriously. So instead, I use three closely related species of wasp that have distinct microbiomes and very similar genomes. And so what I found is, when I transplanted the three different microbiomes from the wasp species into one recipient species, I saw that the best survival and developmental outcomes occurred when the microbiomes were transplanted between wasps of the same species. But when the microbiomes were transplanted between wasps of different species, I saw that there were significant developmental delays and decreases in survival. Now, this result paints the picture that our microbiomes are uniquely qualified for a particular genome. And so this has huge impacts, especially in the field of personalized medicine. For example, imagine you're taking a probiotic, but instead of this cookie-cutter set of microbes, you get this robust microbial community that was catered for you and only you. Or imagine you're suffering from irritable bowel syndrome, but based off your genome, you get to get this microbiome transplant that is going to help to restore your healthy gut. We are entering a world of personalized medicine where our uniquely qualified microbiomes will help us to determine the most effective pharmaceuticals. And so, while the 20th century gave us great breakthroughs in our understanding of the genome, the 21st century will be the age of the microbiome. Thank you.
Thank you. Can Daniel come up to be mic'd, please? Up next, we have Archana Krishnamoorthy with Carpe Tempum Seize the Time.
Let me tell you a secret. We all have superpowers. It's true. Inside each one of us, there exists a system so powerful that it cannot be turned off and it does not have a snooze button. I'm talking about our biological clocks. This internal master timekeeper that resides in the brain uses chemicals to signal to us when it's time to sleep, when it's time to eat, or when it's time to wake up and go to work. These chemical messengers also shape our productivity throughout the day. I'm sure we've all been through our productive peaks, or as I like to call it, the beast mode, when we blaze through our to-do list, get every single item checked off, or conversely, we've also experienced those afternoon slumps when all we just want to do is laze around and watch cat videos. Regardless of what we're experiencing, I'm sure you'll agree when I say that we all go through multiple productivity phases throughout the day. Let me tell you another secret. We're not the only ones with these superpowers. These internal clocks also exist in plants, bacteria, insects, and the hero of my talk, yeast. Yes, the humble baker's brewer's yeast that we use to make bread and beer and wine and all the good stuff also have internal clocks. And I study yeast clocks. I hypothesized that if these yeast have clocks, then they might be going through productivity phases just like most of us. To study this, I engineered these yeast to glow in the dark by giving them DNA from fireflies so they can glow when they're active. And it turns out that just like most of us, yeast are more productive earlier in their day. So why is my research important? Yeast are used to make insulin, antibiotics, growth hormones, and a vast array of other biologically important proteins in the industries in very large amounts. If industries harness this very productive time window to extract proteins like insulin at just the right time, this could save thousands of dollars on manufacturing. My research is thus a novel way to exploit protein harvesting so we can keep up with the ever-increasing demand for insulin and antibiotics. Finally, I'll leave you with this one thought. The next time you're having a creative brainwave, remember, carpe tempum, seize the time. Thank you.
Thank you. Can May come up to be mic'd next? And now we have Daniel Kashima with Drugs Are Sick, TLR4, and Reward Learning.
You want a snack, but you want to eat healthy. So you grab that bag of spinach from the vegetable bin. But a few hours later, you feel really sick. In today's polarized society, the idea that food poisoning is unpleasant may be one of the few things we can actually all agree on. Nothing like a little E. coli and immune activation to tie humanity together. But often lost in this ordeal is another shared trait. We learn. We think, that spinach made me really sick. Maybe I should throw it out. Learning takes place in our brain. Our brain cells, called synapses, communicate with one another our brain cells called neurons communicate with one another through structures called synapses. They are the language of learning. In place of letters, we have changes in the strength of synapses between particular cells. Like the alphabet forming words and sentences, many of these changes form ideas and memories. In general, this is a good thing. If we couldn't change the strength of synapses, we wouldn't learn. Probably eat more of that spinach that made us really sick. But these same mechanisms of learning can also be turned against us. You've probably heard that drugs are bad. Not everyone has a substance use disorder, but unfortunately, this condition also affects family and friends, meaning everyone in this room. Drugs like cocaine are the pirates of our neuronal language. They hijack our learning mechanisms, they rewire synapses in order to found the foundation of addiction. My research looks into the interplay between learning, memory, and reward, but there's a twist. Does the immune system play a role? Is there a link between that E. coli and the spinach and cocaine? Turns out there might be. I use mice to study a protein called TLR4. It's one of our body's security cameras, detecting bacteria like E. coli in order to sound the alarm. Normally, we change the strength of specific synapses through experience. That's how we learn. I found that mice that lack TLR4 have fewer ways to change the strength of synapses. It follows that these mice may have fewer ways to be hijacked by drugs of abuse. In support of this, I found that while normal mice really like cocaine, TLR4 lacking mice don't. This suggests that TLR4 plays a role in learning, memory, and reward. And importantly, this opens up new avenues to study the brain and help those with synapses gone awry. This brings us to today's points of agreement. Food poisoning is unpleasant, learning is good, and drugs are bad. Whether E. coli or cocaine, think about TLR4 the next time you think about reward learning or food poisoning. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Can Iliza come up to be mic next? And now we have Mei Shen with the quest for visual expertise.
Given an X-ray image, Mrs. Red, an expert radiologist, can diagnose Alzheimer's from a single look. In contrast, Mr. Green, an aspiring medical student, still has to guess. This ability that Mrs. Red has, the exceptional ability to make judgments with images, is called visual expertise. Beyond radiology, visual experts like Mrs. Red play important roles in many domains in our society, such as airport baggage screening and forensic fingerprint identification. My research goal is to understand such visual expertise so that researchers can design more effective training systems for students like Ms. Green to develop their visual expertise. Specifically, I study what experts and novices see and how that relates to their performance. I use bird identification ability as an example to answer these questions because bird identification is a commonly used and accessible example of visual expertise, unlike radiology and forensics. First, I study what bird experts and novices see in their mental space. In our mind's eye, we see things as points located in a multidimensional space. For example, everyone has a unique mental space for puppies, with dimensions such as the puppy's size, cuteness, and intelligence. In your puppy space, you might see your own puppy as ranking lower than your neighbor's on the dimension of size, but much higher on the dimension of cuteness, and your neighbor would suddenly have a different puppy space. Your personal puppy space would influence the similarities you observe among different puppies, providing a good metric for me to identify the dimensions of your puppy space. Using this logic, I measure and model bird experts and novices' bird space by gathering their similarity ratings among different birds. This will answer the question of what they see. Then I relate what they see to how they perform, in this case, their bird identification performance. This relationship between what they see and how they perform has significant implications. For example, if there are dimensions in the expert's mental space that are critical for efficient diagnosis using X-ray images, which novices like Mr. Green are not aware of, we can highlight those dimensions in their training to improve the training efficiency. My name's Mei. My research is to help people with the quest for visual expertise. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Can Raj come up next to be mic'd? And now we have Iliza Butera with Listening Through Your Eyes.
If I ask you to imagine a cyborg, you may be picturing a character like RoboCop. But in fact, there are over 500,000 very real people in the world who may also fit this definition. A cochlear implant is a type of hearing prosthetic that picks up sound through a microphone behind the ear. It transmits that sound into these electrical pulses that can then be bypassed around non-functional parts of the ear in order to simulate the auditory nerve. And what this means is that people with profound hearing loss are able to experience sound again, and for the congenitally deaf, they could hear in some cases for the first times in their life. Now, there's one catch. Hearing with a cochlear implant electrically is not nearly as good as acoustic normal hearing. A sentence like, "How is your day?" could sound something like, "Ch-ch-ch-ch." It's It's really noisy, right? And there's one fortunate thing about speech, which is that it's typically both auditory and visual, and the combination of the senses can boost comprehension. Now imagine that tonight you decide to go out for a martini with a friend, and you're trying to listen in a noisy environment, so you're going to tune in to your friend's voice and try to tune out all of the background chatter. And by doing that, you're able to listen in environments that you typically wouldn't be able to. And being able to lip read can mean the difference between carrying on a conversation and really not. So we know that visual information is really important for oral communication, but we don't yet know that much about it in cochlear implant users. I think that the brains of cochlear implant users are actually doing audiovisual integration to a greater extent than typical normal hearing listeners. There's two reasons why I think that. The first reason is that understanding with a cochlear implant is already difficult because the signal is hard to interpret. The second reason is that we know that these periods of auditory deprivation can cause remodeling in the brain, and it could be that that remodeling actually helps to integrate the senses together better. So for my thesis, I'm using powerful magnets of fMRI scanners and lasers in a technology called fMIRS in order to test whether periods of auditory deprivation can lead to visual plasticity that can then support audiovisual integration better to improve comprehension in cochlear implant users. And my hope is that this research will lead to doing routine audiovisual testing in hearing clinics and potentially even visual training in order to make cochlear implant users the highest functioning cyborgs ever. Thank you.
Thank you. Can Samantha come up next, be mic'd? Now we have Raaj Gowrishankar with Emerging Insights into Mental Illness, What's Wrong with My Vacuum Cleaner?
The World Health Organization reports that mental illness accounts for 19% of the global burden to disease, with a global cost of $2.5 trillion. Unfortunately, we still don't fully understand mental illnesses or how to effectively treat them. What we do know is mental illnesses are genetic. That is, they're associated with changes, also known as mutations, in small chunks of our DNA, known as genes. Genes are responsible for making proteins, the tools necessary for brain function. A mutation could lead to a dysfunctional tool and possibly disease. What we also know is that mental illnesses are associated with imbalances in the brain molecule dopamine. Dopamine normally subserves everyday important functions such as reward, motivation, and decision making. But what does all this have to do with a vacuum cleaner? Our brain has its very own molecular vacuum cleaner for dopamine, called the dopamine transporter. As the name suggests, it keeps dopamine levels in check by clearing away all the excess dopamine that's floating in your brain. Scientists recently found that patients with mental illness have reduced levels of this vacuum cleaner in their brains. This finding is monumental because for the first time, we can link deficiencies in this vacuum cleaner to disease. But what this doesn't tell us is why there are low levels of this vacuum cleaner or how this leads to disease. That's where I hope our research can help. We look directly at the gene that makes this vacuum cleaner for mutations in patients with mental illnesses. We found a mutation in this gene that was strongly associated with multiple mental illnesses. We then engineered this mutation into mice, resulting in mice being born with a mutant or defective vacuum cleaner just like the patients are. I'm excited to report that these mice recapitulate multiple behavioral symptoms of many mental illnesses. But the true advantage of this approach is that we can now begin to understand how we get from a mutation to a disease. Our results show that these mutant mice actually have elevated dopamine floating around in their brain. And more excitingly, we found that this elevated dopamine was because their mutant vacuum cleaner was actually running in reverse. We're still trying to understand the implications of this wonderful finding, and our ultimate hope is to reverse this reversal in an attempt to alleviate disease. I can't stress enough that this approach has really opened a new window into studying mental illness, with which we can truly begin to unravel its complexities with the ultimate goal of devising better treatment strategies. Thank you.
Thank you. And last but not least, we have Samantha Sarett with leveraging albumin as a natural carrier for siRNA.
So I want to introduce you all to Officer Small Interfering RNA. Officer siRNA is going after one of the most notorious criminals in your body, the second leading cause of death in the United States, and that's cancer the destroyer. So Officer siRNA is extremely powerful because he has the ability to block the expression of any gene in a cancer cell. But unfortunately, it's really challenging for siRNA to get to the site of cancer. So the most direct route to cancer is through the bloodstream highway. And the bloodstream highway is actually populated by cells and proteins that are always on the lookout for intruders. And to them, Officer siRNA looks like another dangerous foreigner that needs to be cleared out immediately. So Officer siRNA in the bloodstream is immediately kicked out. It can't get to cancer. In contrast, you have Mr. Albumin. He's the most abundant protein in your bloodstream. And Mr. Albumin actually circulates for weeks without clearance. So one particular characteristic of Mr. Albumin is that he's really powerfully attracted to these lovely long lipid chains I'm calling lady lipids. So Mr. Albumin actually chaperones these lady lipids all around the bloodstream. He takes them wherever they need to go. So I hypothesized that if I could make Officer siRNA look just a little bit more like these lady lipids, Mr. Albumin might hook onto him and carry him around the bloodstream into the site of cancer. So I gave Officer siRNA a new look. I gave him a disguise where I attached an albumin-binding lipid to the siRNA molecule. So he goes incognito as siRNA lipid. And when you inject siRNA lipid into your bloodstream, Mr. Albumin grabs him up immediately, promises to take care of him. siRNA lipid circulates for 6 times longer than an unmodified officer siRNA. So this siRNA lipid and albumin complex circulates through your bloodstream together. And that's important because Mr. Albumin is actually best buds with cancer. Mr. Albumin preferentially hangs around sites of cancerous regions more so than it does at any other tissue in your body. And so that means that when siRNA lipid is bound up in this complex with Mr. Albumin, it also preferentially goes to sites of cancer. So that can reduce any side effects that might come from having this therapy throughout your whole body. So Mr. Albumin takes siRNA lipid to the site of cancer. He accumulates there at a really high level and homogeneously throughout the entire cancerous area. And at this point, siRNA lipid sheds his disguise. He's Officer siRNA again. And he can take out genes in cancer cells that are important to, say, cancer cells' survival. So he blocks expression of those genes, and the cancer cells die. Or he can take out the expression of genes that are, say, important to drug resistance in cancer cells. So that'll improve the efficacy of conventional therapeutics, like chemotherapeutics. So, through this really simple modification, I designed siRNA to take out cancer much more effectively. So I give it a much greater potential as an siRNA, as a therapy. Oh, sorry, did you?
Yeah, sorry, I forgot to point this
out. Oh, yeah, I thought, okay. Yeah, sorry. I'm...
All right, that was our final presentation. Thank you all for coming. This was such a delight. I really enjoy hearing from all these other graduate students. You don't always get opportunities to see these interdisciplinary plays at work, so that was lovely. If you could please quickly place your People's Choice ballots into the, we're gonna be passing these bags. Hannah's back there with a bag. If you could place them in the bag, that would be wonderful. And Aaron and Jacqueline, along with their committee, are gonna be tallying up the scores. And so, at this time, I am honored and excited to welcome Chancellor Nicholas Zepos to the three-minute thesis competition, who will be offering some final remarks. Chancellor Zepos, I turn the floor over to you. Thank you so much for being here.
Get the green, red, and yellow out, because I certainly am not as erudite, interesting, or parsimonious as these really, really remarkable individuals. And thank you, first of all, for letting me be part of this extraordinary gathering of talent and hope. And let me say, first of all, how proud I am. How proud I am that you, our students, our graduate students, are doing such extraordinary work. You are just absolutely brilliant, entertaining, engaging, and I wouldn't have held up the yellow, the red. I would have just like, wow, I listened all day. Second thing is I want to say how affirmed I feel. I have in the mission of the university. We are a university committed to graduate education and research of the most significant breadth and impact. And what I saw here was simply extraordinary and makes me want to work even harder, which is my third point, which is I'm inspired. I'm inspired by your work, the passion, the hope that you bring, and inspired to invest much, much more in graduate education, to invest in your programs, your scholarships, your housing, your community on campus. And finally, let me say again how hopeful I am. And I think I'm hopeful because, and I want to recognize Claudia here, how much we have to communicate this. You know, we have to, you know, we're sitting and they're like, we're going to cut 20% from the NIH budget. I'm like, that's really smart. That's really, you know, what we need to do. These are the people that really have nothing to add, nothing to contribute, no ideas. And so your ability to communicate the brilliance, the hope, the technical parts of it, I mean, I think that that is really, really, really hopeful to me. And I will be your partner in getting that message out and getting the funding and really doing everything I possibly can to support what I think is simply the most important thing we do, which is research. And then you do it, and you're smarter than all of us. So thank you very much. And I didn't put a vote in because I would have voted for everybody. I would have had gold, silver, bronze, tin, molybdenum, albumin. I would have had every possible category. So thank you very much. And I think it's time for Erin to come up and she's not quite ready. Oh, we're still, no, we don't have we don't want an Academy Awards snafu. Do you need me to? Do you need me to do like another 15 minutes or anything?
Red card. Thank you very much. You are awesome.
So thank
thank you very much, Chancellor Zeppos, and thank you for being here and supporting us. It means a lot to us. First of all, I would like to start by thanking our judges, so I'm going to hand out and with that, it's very important to us to have the support of the community in this event that we reached outside of Vanderbilt to bring some judges in from all different disciplines. We have radio, we have speech writing, we have professional storytelling, we have the dean of the graduate school, and this is very important to us because the entire event today is about communication. It's about being better at communicating to our peers, to our friends, and to our community. So with that, I want to thank some of the people who participated in that today, starting with our judges, and our generous co-sponsors who made this possible, and the Graduate School and Graduate Student Council for putting this on every year, and the people who participate in this event. So for all of you who stuck around, whether you made the finals or not, we have a couple raffles. So if we have an Austin Featherstone, you have won an Amazon gift card. Do we have a Robin Schaefer? Must be present to win. And these raffles are just a token of our appreciation for you participating in the event today. We have one last Amazon gift card. And I'm going to pronounce this. Archana? Is that how you say that? So she's super lucky. Finals and Amazon. But we have an ultimate giveaway. It's a smart fitness watch. It's Samsung Gear Fit 2, which is compatible with both Apple and Android. So whoever wins can be happy. Also, it can be your new communication piece. So with that, is Cole Brubaker in the audience? So those are the fun raffles that I have, and as the committee continues tabulating, are we close to a... All right, we have people's choice? Do we have the checks? So... this is my first year running 3MT, and I've participated as a volunteer in the past, and as you can see, there are a lot of moving parts. We are very excited to have made it to the end of today and have you all here with us. It's actually a great experience and something that graduate school does not teach you, how to event plan and coordinate 50, 60, 70 speakers in a short time frame. So graduate school. It's good to have people who do that, learning that, but definitely part of the communication and learning how to get people to interact and communicate via email and orally, and I'm wasting time, but I really would like to appreciate and thank everyone who has made it out today because this was a really great event to be a part of. So as they finish writing the names out on our photo ops, originally, we had 76 register. That number dropped to 56 when they had to turn in their slides. And since then, I think today we had just under 50 compete. Perfect. All right. Drum roll, please.
for our People's Choice Award, I think people were hungry.
And then be sure that you get an email from me so that we get you an actual check. So thank you very much. Congratulations.
All right, in second place, I need to know why my vacuum cleaner is broken. Perfect. And for our final grand prize and the theme of what people like, I think beer is pretty popular. You want me to draw again? I can. All right, well, the lucky lady is being very generous today. We have, I'm gonna pick the same names. Do we have a Darren Tinker here still? All right, congratulations, Darren. So again, thank you all for being here. We really appreciate it, and thank you for being so generous and very lucky today. But we appreciate it. We hope to see you all next year. If you're at all excited about getting involved, please send me an email. Thank you.